on September 6, 2005, a girl, aged 17, named Taylor Bell, was murdered. So today I wanted to share with you her story, which is pretty bizarre and gruesome at the same time. A private detective by the name of Charles Mantaldo actually wrote about the past of this young girl before she was murdered, since most news articles seem to only deal with the circumstances after the police was already trying to search for this girl when she went missing. So as always, I wanted to share with you some of the information concerning this young girl before she was murdered, and then we'll get into the details of what actually occurred, or at least how they actually discovered that she was murdered, because after all, in the end, it's another one of those cases where only the perpetrator truly knows what actually occurred that fateful day. Now, Taylor Bell was born on October 13th, 1987. By age 5, her parents were divorced and her mother was remarried to a Royal Air Force officer. She and her new husband and Taylor lived in England and Belgium. Taylor became a seasoned airline passenger before the age of 6, making unescorted international trips between Europe and the United States. By the age of 11, Taylor's mother was divorced again and the two returned to Northern Virginia. Now, as the detective described, she was a pretty and popular girl and had an air of well-traveled sophistication about her. She had attended 15 different schools abroad by the age of 17 when she graduated from Madison High School in the well-off Washington, D.C. She carried the outward appearance of having developed a savvy independence that would prepare her for her next life adventure of attending her first year of college at the Richmond, Virginia-based Virginia Commonwealth University. Janet Pellicera said Taylor selected VCU because of the diversity she would find at the college with its 30,000 students. It seemed like a safe choice, located only 1.5 hours away from both her mother and father. In August 2005, at age 17, she packed up her belongings, as did thousands of other college-bound students, and headed to her new home at Gladding's Residence Dorm on West Main Street in Richmond, Virginia. Now, the detective goes on to describe that one more important aspect of Taylor Bell's life was her participation on MySpace.com. MySpace is so old school by now. Can you guys remember that website? Maybe you've had a profile on it. I remember I had a profile on it, but it's like 10 years ago, man. Time flies. Now, the website is designed so individuals can create profiles for themselves and interact with others in a social type environment. Kind of like Facebook these days, but back then, you know, it was MySpace compared to Facebook. That was still up and coming. On Taylor Bell's profile she created during the summer of 2005, she used the name Bitter and posted, "I just graduated from high school and now I'm off to Richmond for college. I'm looking forward to meeting people that are in Richmond because I only know a few people down there." Later in her profile she added, "Who would I like to meet? Someone who is kind." She posted regularly on the site and continued to do so while at the university. Now this is where the morbid stuff starts to happen, and it would eventually end up in her being murdered. Now, unknown to her parents, Taylor met a man in February 2005 while touring the university as a prospective student. He was Ben Foley, a 38-year-old amateur photographer who had a history of dating young college girls. It is believed that Taylor and Foley developed an online friendship after meeting, and the relationship became sexual at some point. There are conflicting reports concerning when or if Taylor ended the physical relationship, but when she arrived at the university, their friendship continued. On September 5th, Taylor returned to Richmond after visiting her family in Vienna over the holiday weekend. She called her parents to let them know she made it back to the university safely. She then had dinner at the Village Cafe with an old boyfriend. Afterwards, she returned to her dorm room but left to give her roommate and her boyfriend privacy. With her car keys, cell phone, student ID, and a little cash, she told her roommate she was going skateboarding and would be back in 3 hours. Sadly, she was never seen alive again. It was not until September 7th that Taylor's roommate made a missing persons report to the university campus police. On September 15th, the Richmond police took over, and an 11-member task force, including FBI agents, was formed to help find the missing student. In the early morning hours of Saturday, September 17th, 2005, Bell's car was found in a residential neighborhood about 1.5 miles away from the campus. A K-9 unit police were using on the car led them to Jesse Schultz, 22, who lived in the area where Bell's car was found. Police reported that Schultz failed questions on a lie detector test when he claimed not to know and not to have been in Bell's car, and was arrested on cocaine possession. Numerous search warrants were executed, including Bell's mother's home in Vienna, Virginia, and Bell's University Glanning Residence Center dorm room. Those questioned by police at this place of the investigation included Jake, a student and former boyfriend of Bell with whom she had dinner after she returned to Richmond on September 5th, and another unnamed friend of Schultz and Bell whose car was impounded for forensic tests because police believed that Bell might have been in his car before her disappearance. Another of the last individuals to have seen Bell alive was Benjamin Faldy, a 38-year-old amateur photographer, as I mentioned before, and self-described goth skater from the 1980s. Investigators focused on Faldy as they began to uncover his and Bell's relationship. Faldy's attorney, Chris Collins, confirmed that Faldy is a suspect and should be a suspect because he knew her. Police began to become more suspicious when Faldy's alibi did not hold up and executed a search warrant. This was based on offenses Faldy committed, substantially described as taking indecent liberties with children and contributing to the delinquency of a minor. Police were looking for, among other things, women's clothing, Bell's Nokia camera phone, Taylor Bell's keyring, her money, and burglary tools. As a result of the search, Faldy was arrested that day and charged with 16 counts of child pornography. On Wednesday, October 12, 2005, Faldy, against his attorney's advice, spoke to police investigators. He reportedly admitted to being with Bell the night of September 5th and into the early morning hours of September 6th, 2005. He allegedly said that Bell died accidentally during a consensual sex act, likely erotic asphyxiation, with him in her car at Matthews County, Virginia. He claimed he then panicked and dumped her unburied body in a shallow ravine. A surveillance video showed Bell and Faldy entering the University Glanning Residence Center together at 10:18 p.m. and Faldy waiting for Bell in the dorm's lobby while she went to her dorm room. The video's final frames show Bell and Faldy leaving the dorm together. Bell's mother called Faldy a big fat liar and claimed that Bell had sex once out of curiosity with Faldy in April 2005 and then didn't want anything to do with him. On Monday, October 17, 2005, Richmond Circuit Court Chief Judge Margaret Spencer issued a gag order prohibiting witnesses who appear before the court from publicly discussing their testimony, effectively quashing any witness accounts becoming public until Faldy's trial. Since then, court records have shown that on Tuesday, January 17, 2006, Matthews County, Virginia indicted Faldy for Bell's murder. The indictment accuses him of killing Bell willfully, deliberately, and with premeditation while attempting to abduct and rape her. On Monday, February 13, 2006, the indictment was amended, bearing immediate accusations of rape and abduction. The reworded first-degree murder charge now accuses that Faldy did kill and murder Taylor Mary Bell. On Wednesday, August 9, 2006, Circuit Court Judge William H. Shaw accepted Faldy's guilty plea to second-degree murder and sentenced him to 30 years in prison. The guy was already in his 30s, so by the time that he could come out, he would be almost 70 years old, if he's still alive by then. But this to me is absolutely disturbing, the fact that this guy was 38, dating or at least having sex with a 17-year-old girl. In that case, he could have been the father of this girl, and that's always kind of weird to me when people do that shit. But it is what it is. Some people are into older guys, or likewise, guys can be into much older women, I suppose. Sadly, however, and also thankfully, in most cases, it doesn't end up with murder, but sadly, in this case, it did. And his testimony, or at least what he willing to say about the actual scenario that occurred before this young girl's death is absolutely bizarre to me. Him claiming that was consensual sex, but likely erotic asphyxiation. It's like, okay, I can't judge about other people's sex lives, but that sounds really weird to me. That sounds like, I know that is a way some people like their sex, but it could also potentially be him actually trying to cover up that he maybe brutally murdered this girl while he was raping her, like they are accusing him of, because that actually sounds more logical. I don't think a girl that age into that sort of shit, but who am I? Maybe I'm totally wrong, you know? Regardless, I hope she is resting in peace. And thankfully, this creepy guy is behind bars, because it is creepy, man. A 38-year-old man hanging around colleges, wanting to date these young girls. It's just really weird to me. Anyways, you can always leave your thoughts in the comment section below. And as always, dear viewer, have sweet dreams.